अज्ञानां जाह्नवी तीर्थं विद्यातीर्थं विवेकिनां सर्वेषां सुखदं तीर्थं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारती। So, namaskaram to one and all. On behalf of Tattvaloka, I am very happy to welcome you all to today's session. Tattvaloka, as you all are aware, is a monthly magazine published on behalf of the Sringeri Sharada Peetham, established by Jagatguru Adi Shankaracharya about 1200 years ago. It is devoted to spreading Indian wisdom, which is increasingly becoming recognized for its universal relevance, for the solutions it offers to so many problems faced by humanity. I urge you all to take a look at our sample magazine on our website, as well as to subscribe it on the website tattvaloka.com. In the long list of Jagatgurus of our tradition, Shri Krishna Paramatma features prominently. There are thousands of temples dedicated to him, and it is a pleasure to have Dr. Chitra with us, who will be in four sessions covering some significant temples to this Jagatguru, so that we may have a glimpse of the history and the legends behind these temples, and also meditate on the lessons given by Krishna Paramatma. Dr. Chitra is a celebrated scholar on temple architecture and epigraphy. She has a long standing association with Tattvaloka, which we are all very proud of, and her erudite lectures on Vijayanagara architecture and the knowledge that she has shared with us has enriched all of us, and including me. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being associated with us. She'll be accompanied today. She's collaborating today with Master Siddharth, who is an undergrad student of mathematics and computer science. Is that right, Siddharth? At the University of Stanford, US of A. He's a music student learning from Srimati Charumati Raghuraman, S.R. Janaki Raman, and Trivandrum Sita Lakshmi. He's a very common face during the December music season here. So over to you, Dr. Madhavan. I look forward to your erudite session.
Thank you very much, Rohitji, for your kind introduction. Many, many thanks to Tattvaloka for inviting me to deliver the series of lectures on Krishna temples of India. It's like Rohit said, it's been a long-standing association with Tattvaloka, which I cherish from the bottom of my heart. My very sincere thanks to Srimati Sharada Panchakoteshan for asking me to do this lecture, and to Shreya Nagarajan Singh for all the technical assistance that she has been providing for this lecture. And thank you, Yam Siddharth, for agreeing to accompany me. I've been a big fan of yours for very many years now, and happy with this collaboration. So please, this is a series of lectures for, and we'll be dealing with a few temples in as much depth as possible in these four lectures. Give me a second. Let me screen share, please. I need to be allowed to screen share, please.
Yeah.
I still can't.
Just one second. be able to do it now.
Right. So, without further delay, the first temple that we'll be going to is, we're going to Orissa straight away, to Puri, to visit the temple of Jagannath Ji. And for this temple, I'm going to be doing something that I usually don't do. And this is because I don't have many photographs of this temple. So you're going to be watching a lot of words written so that I can share whatever little I know of this temple with you. But for the other temples, I have enough photographs, and so that will be okay. So we all know about this famous temple in Puri, in Odisha. This is Jagannath Ji. There are many people who think of this as a Vishnu temple, and that's absolutely right. There are many who don't think of this as a Krishna temple per se. But of course, it is Krishna, and he is called Jagannath, the Lord of the world over here. Very, very clearly, this is a temple that was not built in a year or in a decade or in a century. It has grown, like very many temples of South India have grown into magnificent proportions. This is also a huge temple complex with many structures being added from time to time to time. So we can see that it's an amalgam of temple architecture. Very, very clearly, this is of the Nagara or the North Indian style, built of sandstone. So, yes, I'm not loud enough.
People are hearing quite a bit of background noise.
Okay. Give me a minute. I'll try to do something about it. Okay. I wonder if this is better. I hope there's no background noise now.
It's much better.
Oh, okay. Very good. Okay, so this is the Nagara style of temple architecture. Interestingly, the Sun Temple in Konark, the famous Surya Mandir, was called the Black Pagoda. And this Jagannath Ji Temple was called the White Pagoda because it was completely covered with chunna, with whitewashing. And this is what the European sailors off the coast of Orissa called both these seaside temples, the one in Konark and the one in Puri. So you can see this much of white now, because the Archaeological Survey of India has been involved in the painstaking work of removing all of that from the shikara, or this part of the temple, over the years. So then, the Bhoga Mantapa, see there are three parts of this temple. The Bhoga Mantapa in front of the main shikara was constructed in the Maratha rule in the 18th century by an architect named Bhaskar Pandit, is the view of one scholar. And it says that cost 40 lakh rupees those days and 12 years to build the Bhoga Mantapa with material brought from Konark's Surya Mandir. So this is the view of one scholar. And there are others who say that it was built in the 15th century AD. Anyway, so this is how this famous, famous Jagannath temple looks. Incidentally, there are other names for this. It's also called Nilagiri and Neelachala, etc. We know that the main deities who are worshipped inside are called Jagannath, Balabhadra, and Subhadra. In fact, the chakra of Krishna, of Vishnu, the Sudarshana chakra is also worshipped alongside. They are called the Chaturtha Murti locally, and the fourfold manifestation of the divine. According to the traditional story of this temple, a king named Indradyumna, a devotee of Vishnu, wanted to see Neela Madhava, a form of Vishnu, which was worshipped deep in the forest. But unfortunately, he was not able to view the deity that he wanted to see, and being very disappointed, prayed to Vishnu. And he heard a divine voice telling him to go to the sea near Puri, in Puri, and he would see a log of wood floating in, and to take that log of wood and keep it aside. He did so, and an old carpenter, who was actually Vishnu in disguise, called upon him and said that he should be left alone with that log of wood for 21 days in a closed room. However, the king and queen, not hearing any noise from inside the room, opened it, only to see that the carpenter had vanished and the three deities were there unfinished. And that is how they are in worship even today. I do not have a photograph of the main deities in worship. So this is an old photograph of the main Shikara, the main part of the Jagannath temple, which is 214 feet and 8 inches in height. And it belongs to the most mature phase of the Odisha style of temple architecture. Yet another old photograph. Now this part of this temple, right on top, you have the Sudarshana Chakra, atop which is a flag which is changed every evening. And a group of temple employees, devotees we should call them, climb up without any kind of support, up this Shikara, climb up right to the top and change the flag, be it a windy day or rain or shine, whatever. So this Neela Chakra, which is, that's what this chakra is called, on top is 3.5 meters, 11 feet, 8 inches high. It signifies the Sudarshana Chakra made of 8 metals, Ashtadhatu in Sanskritam. And every day, that is every evening, a new flag is tied to the mast and the old flag is brought down. So this is how it looks. So in front of this temple, as we enter it, is a stamba, is a pillar that sometimes we miss seeing. And that is a dvajastamba, not made of wood, it's made of stone, chlorite, and it's called the Aruna Stamba. Aruna, we know, is a charioteer of Surya. And this was originally in front of the Konark temple, and it was brought here. This is how it looks, that's Aruna on top. And this is how it is in front of the Jagannath Ji's temple today. We can all see it. The temple opens at 5 a.m., closes past midnight. Many, many, many pujas, rituals happen over there. It was taken over by the Archaeological Survey of India in 1975. And as I said earlier, the lime plaster was removed. All right. I'll go a little fast just to save some time. And the plastering was originally done to protect the temple from the saline, the salt wind, because it's so close to the sea. And then the subsequent plastering obscured many of the sculptures. And this is how the temple seems to have looked, an ugly mass of stone and plaster. But that's not the temple at all. Anyway, because the lime plaster started to become spongy and started leaking, it led to damage, much damage. And finally, it has been removed. So this is a bird's eye view of the temple, massive temple complex it is. Interestingly, there are 4 entrances, each named after an animal. So the eastern entrance is called the Simhadwara. And the southwest and north are called the Ashwadwara, horse, Hastidwara, the elephant, and Vyagradwara, which is the tiger. So these are the 4 entrances. Food for Jagannath Ji is very, very important, called the Bhogha and the Mahaprasad. So this is a huge kitchen, very, very big kitchen. And homam is performed every day before anything is cooked, and the god of fire is worshipped in all temples, that is. And this ritual is at 8 a.m. Different types of food are offered to the deities at different times of the day. And a whole lot of people eat here. Hundreds and hundreds of devotees eat here on an average every day. Right? And it's a very, very, very big kitchen with lots of people working on it. So these are the actual figures. How big the kitchen is. 150 feet long, 100 feet wide, 32 rooms, 250 earthenware, ovens, etc. That many people for making the offering to Jagannath Ji. A big fireplace along with 6 smaller fireplaces all around it. So this is there. Big earthenware pots, 6 small pots, and the food is cooked in 9 pots, sufficient to feed 200 people minimum. So Mahaprasad is the term applied to the 56 food offerings offered to Lord Jagannath. And you can read this. Plenty is offered, plenty is given to the devotees. So I'm giving a lot of details about what are the different offerings given to this deity. Lots of dry fruits, dry sweets, savories, many, many different kinds of sweets, etc. So whatever is given to the deity is called Nirmalya in this temple. So this is how the bhog actually looks, all in earthenware pots like this. Okay, so what is given to the Lord becomes the prasad. What we in the south say as a naivedyam and then the prasadam. Okay, utsavams, festivals of the Jagannath temple, many, many, many. Every, you know, of Srirangam, it is said, Ranga Yatra Dine Dine. That's what Kulishekhar Alvar said. Every day there's a festival. So much for the Jagannath temple also. There's that much, almost every month. So these are the different festivals that are there. November, December, December, January, February, March, April, May, June, every month, literally. It goes on and on. I'm just giving a brief description. Attires, Vishnu is Alankara Priyaha. We say Alankara Priyo Vishnu. He's adorned with different attires. And there are days of the year when he should be adorned like this. Altogether, 36. Vesham is an attire. So these are all, some are like Rama, some are like Krishna, very many other incidents from the Puranas, according to which he is adorned, he is dressed. All right, so it relates to Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavata Purana. Obviously, the garments, the veshas relating to Krishna are far more in number than the others. So, on different days, there are different colors of silk cloth that are draped on the deity. So, these are the different colors on the different days. Red, white, green, gold, white, black, etc. So the most important part of this entire temple ethos in Puri is the famous Rath Yatra. There are, of course, three Rathas, one for Krishna, Jagannathji, one for Balabhadra, and one for Subhadra. I don't have time to go into very great details of the Rath Yatra. That itself will take more than an hour to talk about. This is just a superficial covering of this. It's also called the Gundicha Yatra, as you can read on the screen. It's a 9-day festival in June, July. The deities are taken to the Gundicha temple, which is about 3 kilometers from the main temple, in beautifully, beautifully decorated chariots. And this place is called the Garden House of Jagannath. Comes to life only during these days of the entire year. We all know that this is how the chariots look, and the thousands and thousands of people who actually attend this mammoth festival. This is a painting from the previous century, and this is how the streets of Puri once looked. No more are they like this. So there are many more details about this. The three chariots for Jagannath, Balabhadra and Subhadra are constructed afresh. 125 carpenters work for 58 days. They are very, very richly decorated. Each has a name. The one for Jagannath is called Nandi Ghosh, and also as Garuda Dvaja. It's 45 feet in height, and the wheels have a diameter of 7 feet. The Navakalevara is Navakalevara also. Both B and B are interchangeable. It's a very, very important ritual as far as the Puri temple is concerned. It is said to have started in either the 13th or in the 14th centuries AD, either in the reign of King Anandha Bhimadeva III or in the reign of King Bhanudeva II. So this is done in a year when there are 2 full moons in the month of Ashada, and a year with an extra, adhika, Masa is considered auspicious for this particular ritual. So lots of people visit this. What actually happens is that these are images of wood. These are dharu bearers. These are images of wood. And therefore, they have to be changed from time to time. There are many other temples in India which have had or still have images of wood. For example, we are coming right here to Kanchipuram, to the famous Varavaraja Perumal temple. You all know of the great festival that took place last year of Atti Varadar, who is in this tank, which is called the Ananta Saras, right underneath this. So this image is also of Daru, is wood, and it's taken out once in 40 years. And it is, well, once the stone image was put in the main sanctum, the wooden image was put in a chamber underneath this tank and taken out only periodically. That's Atti Varadar, as you can see over here, made of the Atti tree. Similarly, in the Jagannathji temple, the old deities are taken out in a ritual, the power being transferred to the new deities that are also of wood. And there is a place inside the temple called Goyil Koyili Vaikuntha, where the deities are buried. So, while images of stone and metal need not be changed, unless, of course, they are very badly damaged, those of wood have to be periodically replaced. So, the old ones are kept in this place, the Koyili Vaikuntha, and the new ones are put in their place with elaborate rituals and absolute secrecy. So, no ordinary neem tree can be used to make the deities. That you, when they go into the forest to cut the tree for each of these three deities, some conditions are taken into account. So the tree that is cut for Jagannathji should be dark in color and must have signs of Shankha and Chakra, which well-informed people are able to identify. The tree for Balabhadra should be light brown or white in color, and the mark of a plough, that is Balabhadra's insignia, should be there. The tree for Subhadra should be yellowish and must have the mark of a lotus flower. So these are things that the ordinary man cannot identify. And the tree for Sudarshana, who is also in worship over there, should be reddish in color and must have the sign of a chakra with a hole in the middle. That's Sudarshana. And after the sacred trees are located and after they're cut with appropriate rituals, and then they come all the way to Puri, and they are carved into the deities within the temple premises. And you can see that power is taken from the old deities and given to the new deities, and the old images are buried. So many, many conditions have to be fulfilled for making the deities anew every time. So interestingly, I'm coming back to the Varadaraja Swami temple in Kanchipuram, where for those who have been there, you can easily understand this. The main deity in the Varadaraja Swami temple is on a small hillock. There are steep steps leading up. And when you want to do a pradakshina, so a circumambulation, the first enclosure around the main deity, the first pradakshina patha, has on its walls paintings from the Vijayanagara times of about the 17th century of all the 108 Divyadeshams. How they actually knew about all these things that many centuries back, how they had visited these places, and each of these images over there, this is the Varadaraja Perumal temple, each of these images portrays not only the main deity, but the Utsava Murti, as also Goddess Lakshmi in that temple. So this is what you have for one temple. This is what you have for another temple. I'm just showing you the main one and the Utsava Murti over here. So we know that each and every temple is unique. Yet another one. And who do you have here? We have the god of Puri as well. Many other temples are also shown. This also is there in the Varadaraja Swami temple. Just a very, very brief outline of the Jagannathji temple. And I request Yam Siddharth now to please take over and sing about the deity. Siddharth, please.
Yes. Tadari na ra 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 Tadara ra ri na Chita nila kale vara chandana charchita nila kale vara chandana charchita nila kale vara pita vasana vanamali chandana charchita nila kale vara Pitavasana vanamali Keli chalalmani kundala mandita Keli chalalmani kundala mandita Keli chalalmani kundala mandita Kalda yuga smita shali radhe Kalda yuga smita shali radhe Hariri amoghava bhuni kare Vilasini vilasati keli pare radhe Hariri amoghava bhuni Nikare Shri Jaya Deva Kaveri Damakuda Shri Jaya Deva Kaveri Damakuda Keshava Keli Raghasyam Shri Jaya Deva Kaveri Damaguda Keshava Keli Rahasyam Vipina Vinoda Kalavalitam
वित नो तु शुभानीय शस्यं राधे विपिन वि नोदक लावलितं विद नो तु शुभानीय शस्यं राधे विपिन विनोद कलावलितं विद नो तु शुभानीय शस्यं राधे हरिमुग्धवधु निकरे ವಿಲಾಸಿನಿ ವಿಲಸತಿ ಕೇಳಿ ಪರೇರದೆ ಹರಿರಿಹ ಮೋದವದು ನಿಕರೆ
I need to be able to screen share, please. All right. Just a little more information. There is a Jagannathji temple. It's a new one in a place called Dakshina Chitra on the East Coast Road, very near Chennai. So I understand that most of the audience for this is from Chennai. So here it is, a miniature of the Jagannathji temple. So those who can't go to Puri can make it. There's the Neera Chakra. There's the flag flying above with the symbol of the sun and moon. These are the deities in worship in Dakshina Chitra. Okay, we go to the next temple, also in North India. We are going to Nath Dwara in Rajasthan, to the temple of Srinath Ji. After looking at the mammoth temple of Jagannath Ji in Puri, this is a very, very small temple of which I don't have enough pictures. In fact, for those used to seeing huge temple complexes like the ones in South India and several in the north, this hardly looks like a temple. It's more like a haveli. Nath Dwara literally means the portal of God. And this is about 48 kilometers from Udaipur in Rajasthan. And it was in the 15th century that an image of Krishna carrying the Govardhana hill, as you can see in this image, was in Mathura. And it was discovered near the Govardhana hill in Mathura. The deity was consecrated and worshipped there with great reverence. But in the second half of the 17th century, the then Rana of Mewar in Rajasthan decided to move this image from Mathura, fearing an attack on this city, and he wanted the image to be safeguarded. So the deity was taken and loaded onto a cart and to be brought to Mewar. But it got stuck. The wheels of the cart got stuck in a place called Silhar, and it was decided that Krishna wanted to reside over there. And that place is now Nath Dwara. This happened approximately in the year 1672. The main image is made of black stone, and he is said to be worshipped here as a child, Krishna, 7-year-old child. This temple is connected to the Pushtimarg or the Vallabha Sampradaya of Vallabhacharya, whose date is 1479 to 1531 AD. And who is famous as the propagator of the Bhagavata Dharma. And we all know that the Vallabha Sampradaya is mainly followed by the people of Gujarat and Rajasthan. And this deity, Srinath Ji of Nath Dwara, is the presiding deities of the Pushtimargis, the Pushtimarg faith. Very unpretentious temple, though it draws so many hundreds of devotees over the year. And it's on a small hillock, and devotees have to walk up a narrow lane to reach this temple. Many are the darshans per day, and many are the food offerings that are given to this young Krishna. Many, many food offerings are given. Now, what makes this temple really important is its association with the Pichwai tradition of painting. The word pichwai literally means at the back or hung at the back. And these paintings have traditionally been used as a backdrop or a curtain for this deity in the Nathdwara temple. The main theme, the central, the focus of any pichwai painting is Krishna. And these paintings narrate the different episodes from his life. And they also correspond to the different seasons, the different ritus. Ras Leela, the holy festival, the Govardhana Puja, etc., etc., are the main themes of the Pichwai paintings. And they are held very, very sacred by the devotees. They are taken, bought from the painters, offered to the temples, taken to the houses, and hung in several houses with very, very great reverence. The town of Nathdwara is so closely connected with Srinathji that it is sometimes called Srinathji itself. The town itself is called Srinathji by many. So these are some of the Pichwai paintings where you can see Srinathji always, always as the central figure over here. These are some of the many Pichwai paintings. And even today, you can see traditional artists hard at work in their places of work around the temple. Vallabhacharya, to whom we all owe so much. There's another temple in Rajasthan for Krishna, which is not so famous as the Nathdwara temple for Srinathji. This is in a place called Kankroli, which is also close to Udaipur. And here it's the Dwarakadish temple. So this is how the Kankroli temple looks. Also a very, very small temple. And it's about 48 kilometers northeast of Udaipur, not too far from Nathdwara. And this is in Rajasamand district. This was constructed in 1636 AD. Again, one of the important temples of the Pushtimag sect of Vallabhacharya. This image of Krishna too is said to have come from Mathura in around 1671 AD during the rule of Maharana Raj Singh I, the king of Mewar, was consecrated in this temple. And in 1676, the main pujas were done. Bal Krishna Ji, the grandson of Vallabhacharya, is said to have taken the initiative to conduct the worship of the image of Dwarakadish in Kankrodi. And this is built in the famous Haveli style of temple architecture that we all know. Very bright, very colorful paintings on the walls of this temple. And the main image is in a standing pose with four hands. The upper hand holds the gada. Another hand holds the Sudarshana Chakra. Upper left holds the Sudarshana Chakra. Lower right is in Bharata Hasta or the boon giving pose. The lower left holds the Shankha called the Pancha Janya. And near the feet of Sri Dwarkadish are four devotees. Their daily rituals are conducted according to the Pushtimargi tradition. So a whole lot of devotees visit the Dwarkadish temple in Kankroli. But when we from the south go there, not many of us know about Kankroli, which is as beautiful as the Nathdwara temple. So over to Siddharth.
Krishna Twadiya Bada पंकज पंचरांतम् कृष्णत्वदीय पद पंकज पंचरांतम् अद्यैव मे विशतु मानस राजहंसः Krishna Twadiya Pada Pankaja Pancharanto Adhyaiva Me Vishatu Manasa Raja Hamsaha Oh. प्राण प्रयाण समय प्राण प्रयाण समय प्राण प्रयाण समय कपवात पित्तैः प्राण प्रयाण समय कपवात पित्तैः कंठावरोधन विधौ कंठावरोधन विधौ स्मरणं कुतस्ते स्मरणं कुतस्ते स्मरणं कुतस्ते स्मरणं कुतस्तु
So we've traveled to Puri in Odisha. From there, we went right across to Rajasthan, to Nathdwara and to Kankroli. From there, we are coming to Karnataka. We are coming to a place called Doddamallur, also called Mallur. We are coming to a lovely temple, very nice temple for Vishnu, called the Aptrameya Swami Temple. This place is on the Bangalore-Mysore highway, about 60 kilometers from Bangalore. It's a very famous temple situated on the west bank of River Kanva, which is a tributary of the Kaveri. Historical village, Mallur or Doddamallur, both names. There are many inscriptions in this temple. I'll show them to you through this slideshow. And from those inscriptions, we understand that this place was, which is now called Doddamallur, was once called Mallur Agraharam, Jnana Mantapa Kshetram, Rajendra Simha Nagari, and Rajendra Simha Chaturvedi Manganam. This Rajendra that I have just mentioned is the famous Gangaikonda Chola, the very illustrious son of Rajaraja Chola, who ruled from Gangaikonda Cholapuram, his capital. So according to many scholars, the Aptrameya Swami temple is a pre-Chola temple on the foundations of which the present shrine was constructed during the days of Rajaraja Chola. It's likely that the main sanctum, the Garbhagraha, and the Mantapa in front, the Mahamantapa and the Arthamantapa, are products of the Chola times. However, in later times, during the reign of the Hoysala kings, who ruled from Dwara Samudra, which is Halebid, not too far away from Doddamallur, and also in the subsequent Vijayanagara period, which started in 1336, many more parts of this temple were added. So you have some Chola, some Hoysala, Vijayanagara, etc. It's an amalgam of different styles of architecture over different eras, as are many temples in India. So this is how the main deity, Vishnu, not Krishna, of Aptrameya Swami looks. So he is about 4 feet in height. He holds a shankha and a chakra in his upper hands. Right hand is an Abhyahasta. Left hand holds the gada. It's Gadahasta. So why are we talking about exclusively Vishnu temple over here? Now let us see. The processional deity, that's the goddess of this temple, who is enshrined in a separate sanctum inside the temple's premises, is Aravindavalli Thaya. It's a rare name for goddess Lakshmi, not one of the more popular names. She's goddess Aravindavalli, and he is Aptrameya Swami. Let's not look at this caption. They're very very bewitching deity and Tayar as well. So this is how you actually go into the temple premises. Not many people from other parts of India visit this temple, but if we like temple art, architecture, sculpture, history, Vishnu, rituals, festivals, everything, we must visit this temple. So here we are. This is the Gopuram through which we go. This is how we enter. We'll come to this Mantapa a little later. It has lots of sculptures on it. This Mantapa has. Now, when we go into this temple through the Prakaram, we go to a shrine for Krishna. And this is Navaneetha Krishna. This is how he is seen over here. In fact, this Krishna is so famous that many people who come in come with the purpose of worshipping this Krishna. Especially people who want to have children come directly to this Krishna Sandhadi. Aparameya Swami is there. He is also in worship. Aravindi Tayar is also there. It is this Krishna who captivates the hearts of most people who come into this temple. Aparameya Swami is magnificent. He has a great personality. But then when this Krishna is there, he steals everybody's hearts. So this is the Prakaram. This is how one comes in to worship Krishna over here. It's a fairly big temple. So this divine child is seen wearing a number of jewels like chains, armlets, anklets, etc. There are many other deities inside this temple complex. You have Vaikunthanatha, you have Annapurni Devi, many of the Arvars who are the 12 great devotees of Vishnu. We have many Acharyas, preceptors, Ramanujacharya, Vedanta Deshika, etc. And this is a temple, as I said, an active worship. So you have very many Vahanas, of which I'm showing you only the Garuda Vahana. You can see the Hamsa Vahana at the back, etc. On the walls of the temple are inscriptions, as you can see. Very many of them. I'll try to show you quite a few. So what do these inscriptions actually tell us? Many of them are of the Chola times. So if we are wondering how come there is a Chola era temple, it's actually a pre-Chola era temple, but the Cholas did so much for it. Their donations are also there. How come it's there in a place as far away as the Mysore area? Because the Cholas did conquer many of these areas. There are their contributions written in the form of inscriptions in quite a few temples over here in this region. So one of these inscriptions is dated 1019 AD, which corresponds to the reign of Rajendra Chola, who ruled from 1012 to 1044. It's probably the earliest epigraph in this temple, and it refers to the important people, Mahajanas of Malavur, alias Rajendra Simha Chaturvedi Mangalam. And the inscription says, was signed by the villagers and in the name of Aprameya, the deity of this village. The deed was signed in the name of this god itself. Another stone inscription datable again to the same king, emperor, in 1034, records that the assembly of this village granted certain lands for rice offerings to God Aprameya Swami. Yet another inscription refers to a donation of land to Aprameya Pirumal, it says. And very interestingly, the same inscription mentions that a person named Neelakanta Devar made a generous donation for the replacement of jewelry which was lost. He also gave some money to the Mahajanas, the important people of this village, for repairing a tank. Lots and lots of information do we get, very interesting information. This is the main sanctum. This is the main Vimanam that we have over here. Lots of images of Vishnu in Ardha Padmasana. You have Narasimha over here alone, without Lakshmi, without being in the yogic posture, without being Ugra Narasimha. This is Narasimha seated. You have Lakshmi Narayana, very many images. And the carvings on some of the pillars are very, very exquisite. There's a pillared veranda that runs right around this temple. So you have the Tulasi Madam here. mini sculptures, especially of Krishna. So when we wander around this raised veranda in the Prakaram, we see a number of images. The Dashavatara are carved over here. These are later period, not Chola, much later, Vijayanagar. So you have the Matsya, the Kurma, Varaha here. That was the Sudarshana Chakra in between. Sthanaka Narsimha, standing Narsimha, Vamana, Parashurama, Sri Rama, Balrama, and many a Krishna. So many Krishnas are over here. This is Krishna with Bakasura. He's killing Bakasura. This is called Bakasura Vada. Many, many more images of Hanuman, etc. These are the inscriptions. Worth their weight in gold. They tell us so many things. In active worship, as I said, is this Aprameya Swami temple in Doddamallur. In a very, very good state of upkeep as well. Here is one of the emperors of the Vijayanagara times, directly in worship over here. As you enter through the Gopuram, as in many Vijayanagara and post-Vijayanagara period Gopurams, if you look to the right and if you look to the left, you'll see two beautiful women. They are respectively goddesses Ganga and Yamuna. It is said that as we go through the doorway, we cleanse ourselves mentally and physically in the waters of the rivers, these sacred rivers, and then step into the holy premises of the temple. So generally, Ganga and Yamuna are seen standing on aquatic animals, which are their vahanas, and she holds a creeper, which goes up in coils like this. And this is of Ganga Devi, the other one will be of Yamuna Devi, and they meet right on top of the ceiling. This actually represents vegetation, which translates into prosperity. These are river goddesses, which give you so much. So there on the other side, you have the other river goddess and all the vegetation that goes up and meets near the ceiling. Veer Hanuman is also there on one of the pillars of this temple. So in pre-Vijayanagara times, you hardly see Hanuman like this, striding forward with one hand raised up above, the tail curled above his head, and the left hand generally holding the stalk of a lotus bud. Anywhere and everywhere you turn in Hampi, you see Veera Hanuman. And Vyasaraya or Vyasatirtha, a very great Acharya of the Madhva sect who lived in the time of Krishnadevaraya in the 16th century, is said to have consecrated that many images of Veera Hanuman all over South India. So Krishna is here, Krishna is there, everywhere in the temple and in worship on a pillar as well. So this is a temple that is protected by the Karnataka State Department of Archaeology in a very good state of preservation. So these are some more inscriptions that you see over here, from which you can find out the date of the temple and many more details. A nicely carved doorway leading into the temple's premises. While you come out of the temple, you see a mantapa, which is called the Purandara Mantapa. And it's called the Purandara Mantapa because the great composer Purandara Dasa is said to have sat over here and composed the famous, famous song, which you will hear young Siddharth sing in a few minutes from now. I am very quickly taking you from Doddamallur to another place in Karnataka, a renowned World Heritage Site, Hampi. So we cross the river Tungabhadra, and this is where Hampi is situated. The famous, famous Vijayanagara Empire at its height looked like this. And this is the insignia of the Vijayanagara dynasty, as you all know, Varaha with a sword in front and Surya and Chandra on top. So we are going into the heart of Hampi, on one side of which you have the river Tungabhadra, literally on the bank of the river Tungabhadra. And this is what I'm going to take you to is a protected monument also. And you have this mantapa leading all the way down to the river. This is the famous, famous Purandara Mantapa, from which you have a great view of the rock river. The scenic Hampi is in full view from here. It's a very, very sacred place. And this is where Purandara Dasa is supposed to have sat and composed many, many of his songs. So even if a person who's not musically inclined sits in this mantapa, you would feel like listening to a song. So this is how it is. You can go in there on a hot summer day and it's so cool inside. This is how the inside of the Purandara Mantapa actually looks. So over to you, Siddharth.
ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣಾ ಆಡಿಸಿದಳ ಯಶೋಧಾ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣಾ ಆಡಿಸಿದಳ ಯಶೋಧಾ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣಾ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಆಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ. ಜಗದೋ ಉದ್ಧಾರಣ ಮಗನಿಲ್ದು ತಿಳಿಯುತ್ತ ಉದ್ಧಾರಣ ಮಗನಿಲ್ದು ತಿಳಿಯುತ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಮಗನಿಲ್ದು ತಿಳಿಯುತ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಮಗುಗಳ ಮಣಿಕ್ಯನ ಹಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಯಶೋಧ ಮಗುಗಳ ಮಣಿಕ್ಯನ ಹಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ. ಅನೋರಣಿಯನ ಮಹತೋಮ ಹೀಮನ ಪನೋರಣಿಯನ ಮಹತೋಮ ಹೀಮನ ಪನೋರಣಿಯನ ಮಹತೋಮ ಹೀಮನ ಅಪ್ರಮೇಯ ನ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಯಶೋಧ ಅಪ್ರಮೇಯ ನಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋಧಾರಣ ಪಾಡಿಸಿದಳ ಶೋಧ ಜಗದೋ ಧಾರಣಂ. Param Purusha na Paravasudevana. Param Purusha na Paravasudevana. Param Purusha na Paravasudevana. Param Purusha na Paravasudevana. Param Purusha no Paravasudevana. Purandara Vithalana Aadisidale Yashodha. Purandara Vithalana Aadisidale Yashodha. Purandara Vidavalana Aadisidale Yashodha. Jagado Dharana Aadisidale Yashodha. Jagado Dharana.
So thank you, friends. That brings us to the end of the first session, and we'll meet in session 2 with many more temples of Krishna around India. Thank you all so much for listening. Thank you, Siddharth. You sang beautifully. Thank you. Thanks to everybody at Tattva Loka for making this happen.